All right, looks like I have the top of the hour on my clock, so we're going to get started. Welcome, everyone. I hope you're all having a good day so far. We are going to just dive right in so that there's enough time for answering some questions at the end. Hopefully you learn some things and have some questions from what I teach you, and that way we can get a little deeper into what we're doing. So the focus of the presentation today is going to be on ways to help manage stormwater runoff from developed areas with low impact but highly effective landscaping elements. The ideas that are presented will follow the accepted practices from green infrastructure and low impact development design. So I'm your host, Sam Justice, and I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of Wisconsin with degrees in civil and geotechnical engineering. I'm one of the engineers here at Presto Geosystems, and we manufacture erosion control, stormwater management, and porous pavement products. Our office is located in northern Wisconsin, and we work all over the US and the world on a wide variety of projects. So a quick description of who we are for those who may not know. Presto Geosystems worked with the US Army Corps of Engineers to develop the geocell technology in the late 1970s, and we've continued to be the leader in innovation in this ever since. We work with customers from the initial concept phase through construction to support a successful project. We have a worldwide distribution network experienced not only in geocell technology, but other geosynthetics as well. Our assistance does not stop when the product leaves the door. We're going to be with you every step of the way. So we do operate in sort of three main product areas. The first one is going to be using the GeoWeb GeoCell. So this is going to be used for things like load support, slope and channel protection, and then constructing green retaining walls. Another product area is going to be porous pavements, of which we have both a vegetated and an aggregate solution. And then finally, lightweight reusable construction mats. So we're going to cover actually quite a few of these different areas today, including our porous pavements, and using the GeoWeb system for channels and green retaining walls. So we're going to cover a bit of a variety. Learning objectives, got to have those. So here are some of the things that I hope you get out of today's presentation. Learn what low impact development and green infrastructure means for different project sites and how the regulations can be handled. Then we're going to get into the applications that follow these guidelines, including cover porous pavements, vegetated swales, and living green walls. So everybody's muted today, but if you do have questions, feel free to type them in the questions tab in your GoToWebinar menu. And we're gonna do a bit of a Q&A at the end to try and go through some of those questions, make sure everybody understands what's going on, feels comfortable, or knows how to reach me if you do come up with questions later. So let's dive right in. So green infrastructure is about people harnessing nature and using it as an infrastructural system. The point of green infrastructure, or GI, is to figure out construction and building techniques that work with the water cycle and help keep stormwater under control. On the other hand, you have low impact development, LID. So this is going to be an approach to land development or redevelopment that works with nature to manage stormwater as close to its source as possible. And LID also emphasizes conservation and using on-site features to help protect water quality. So green infrastructure and low impact development have similar goals. That's related to land planning and design that include ways to reduce your stormwater runoff and promote natural water infiltration from the ever increasingly built up environment as naturally as possible. That's the sort of the key that we're gonna keep talking about. We want this to be natural. We wanna try and simulate the natural groundwater cycle as close as we can while still achieving what our project goals are. So a couple common examples of planned green infrastructure and low impact development systems are things such as rain gardens. Rain gardens are built to absorb runoff from pavements and parking lots and can also be integrated with bioswales or just a vegetated swale or things like green medians. These all allow for immediate water infiltration along your roadways and parking lots. You can also have things such as green roofs that help control temperature and the water flow of new or renovated buildings, and porous pavements for that immediate infiltration in your parking areas rather than having to collect runoff. So reducing a site's overall environmental impact can help you reach your green infrastructure, low impact development, or just general green building goals, especially when you're building in protected or densely populated areas. It can also help you meet stormwater regulations that limit the amount of hard surfaces in your communities. That's going to be your concrete and your asphalt. And so the amount of that impervious surface allowed on a project site is often a concern when you're working along shorelines, in areas that have high water tables, and in newly built residential areas. Though honestly, really should be considered for every project. It is something that we're going to have to deal with for a long time. So with green infrastructure and low impact development practices, there are numerous benefits for using vegetated systems. Generally, any vegetated solution benefits by creating a highly aesthetic natural green space in your community with park-like settings that have a double intention to help promote that infiltration of stormwater. Additionally, vegetated surfaces are much cooler compared to asphalt or concrete pavements. So you're reducing that heat island effect that is inherent with so much hard surfaces in cities. So it's just a lot more comfortable for humans to be around and to be able to walk through and use these spaces when you have that sort of break in the heat. Okay, so like I said, we're going to cover a lot of stuff today. So let's first focus on porous pavements, the options that are available, benefits of using it, and how they can be integrated into your GI and LID development. So the regulatory market has been driving the need for things such as porous pavements for the last 10, 15 years. High stormwater management value is the desire to make the best use of valuable high-cost land and reduce the need for infrastructure such as stormwater ponds or bioswales by increasing the porosity of your pavement. And after 40 plus years, the Clean Water Act continues to create the need for stormwater management for both quantity and quality. And most states have developed their own non-point pollution regulations with specific targets that need to be met. Local regulations may require even more stringent standards if the project is near a protected wetland or a water source. Porous pavements are one way to meet these criteria while still performing in a structurally meaningful and long-lasting way. And sustainable solutions are really popular with the public right now because of the high percentage of recycled materials, reducing landfilling of those materials, and the ability to achieve green building credits on your project site. So the more traditional and probably the more well-known option for porous pavements is to use the porous version of your traditional pavement. So that's going to be your porous concrete, porous asphalt, and permeable paver blocks. These applications allow for normal traffic frequency use, have increased infiltration over their hard surface or their non-porous counterparts, and can help with meeting stormwater requirements. Hard surface porous pavements act very similarly to their non-porous counterparts. So concrete is going to be really similar to porous concrete, but the porous concrete is often going to suffer from things such as durability challenges. The biggest difference between your standard pavement and a hard surface porous pavement is going to be in the overall cross section of the system. All three of these methods require deeper cross sections than the standard pavement section and require something that's called a choker or a bedding course. This is going to be between the top pavement layer and your open graded base layer. This choker layer is intended to be both the level layer for the surface pavement, so it ensures a smooth and proper surface, but it's also intended to provide the resistance to movement or differential settlement that could damage the surface over time. So it definitely has an important function, but it can be costly and time-consuming to install properly. I did mention that durability challenges are an issue, as well as a few other sort of significant drawbacks to using, you know, the hard surface porous pavements that may be, you know, considered a little more traditional. So cost is going to be one of the biggest factors, always is, right? So this is cost both during installation of the project and over the project lifetime. During construction, these products need specialized materials to create the pavement and specially trained contractors that know how to properly install this type of system. There's a lot of long-term maintenance requirements for these types of systems as well. Regular deep cleaning, such as vacuuming and power washing, is required to reduce clogged areas, which happens often in high traffic areas, so like your drive lanes of your parking lots. Resurface or replacement of lost material due to raveling. And raveling is where you start losing individual components due to the weak bonds between all the materials, is also really common. And that choker, that bedding course that we just talked about, it actually impedes the water flow through the system, reducing the infiltration capacity and leading to ponding at the surface. That's kind of the opposite of what we're going for here, right? There's another type of porous pavements out there on the market, and that's going to be ones that's made from molded high-density polyethylene, HDPE. Instead of adaptations of existing pavements, like a porous asphalt, this type of solution is designed from the ground up to function solely as a porous pavement. The molded paver units have strong, rigid walls and are designed specifically for either a vegetated or a stone solution. So this is the type of porous paver unit that we offer here at Presto Geosystems. We have both our GeoBlock and GeoPave systems. That's what we're going to talk about a little bit more. So like I said, there are two different surfaces that can be used with our porous pavement systems: topsoil with vegetation, so you get a nice green lawn, or gravel for that stone surface. This rigid porous pavement system will work well with both options, so it's really up to you to decide what you need for your site. The biggest difference between the two, besides how they look, obviously, is going to be the amount of vehicle traffic that they're able to withstand. With the vegetated system, vehicle traffic should be occasional. Think only a few times a week. This is because no matter how great the system is, grass just doesn't like to be driven on. Too much time getting crushed under cars is going to kill the grass, no matter what. The system will still work. You can still drive on it, no issues, but you won't have that nice green lawn that you might have been hoping for. So if your pavement is planning on seeing daily use, aggregate infill is going to be the way to go. And so we call it non-bound aggregate because there's no glue, no resin, no binders that hold the stone together, just the paver unit itself. So no special materials required. So with GeoBlock, which are our grass pavers, this is so one of our two options made with that rigid porous paver unit. So this is where the panels are not meant to bend or twist. It's going to be, you know, a strong, rigid section that isn't going to be flexible. The rigid nature means that a thinner cross-section is possible and is a stronger system compared to those that might be made just of geotextiles or a traditional pavement material such as concrete. An important aspect of the GeoBlock units is going to be the large amount of open space at the bottom of the cell. You can see that in the photo there. And this allows for full root penetration. So the grass surface is thick and uniform. So you're not limited to the thickness of the paver unit. It can get down into the native ground and really take root, get healthy. And so the cells are filled in with either topsoil, or you could fill them with sod if you're looking for something a little more immediate. Otherwise, the vegetation is then allowed to grow. It's going to actually grow up above the GeoBlock cell walls. So you're not actually going to see any of the black plastic, just a nice green lawn. So the uses for the GeoBlock grass pavers are, like I said, meant to be that occasional use. So think things like fire access lanes. Hopefully you're not using that every day. special event or overflow parking at parks, churches, stadiums, something that you don't need to use every day, but maybe during special events. Basically, anywhere that you're not seeing traffic every single day, vegetated solution may be the way to go. So that's the first option, geoblock grass pavers. Second option is going to be our geopave gravel pavers. So I know that there's going to be some confusion. Geoblock and geopave are really similar names. So I'm going to try and make sure to differentiate the two as we go forward to help you sort of keep in mind. But it's not necessarily the most important for you to remember the name. You can just tell us, hey, I'm looking for the gravel surface or the vegetated surface, and we can make sure you get the right one for you. Okay, so the geopave gravel units are going to be really similar to the geoblock grass units. They have that same rigid paver characteristic, but they have a special feature that's needed for the performance with that stone infill. And what I really want to highlight is going to be what we call the monolithic mesh bottom. You can see that in the photo there. It's the really tight grid within each one of the cells. So this is a molded in-place mesh on the underside of the paver unit. Rather than having those large openings for root penetration, you have this mesh, and it actually helps keep the stone infill from migrating underneath the unit. So it holds the stone in place so it doesn't get lost. So this lattice bottom spreads the load similar to a snowshoe effect. So the wheel loads from cars don't create ruts due to high traffic volume. And the units are designed specifically to work with the different types of infill, either the geopave aggregate pavers or the geoblock grass pavers, to create the best possible pavement section for your needs. So that's why we have the two, is they work a little bit different for the types of infill, but they provide the same great porous pavement solution overall. So applications for geopave aggregate pavements are going to be really similar to what we just saw, but there are no traffic frequency restrictions. Feel free to drive on them all day long. So again, things like access lanes, especially for utilities, is a great option, but also parking lots, road shoulders, or other pull-off areas on the side of roads. And then also things like trails and sidewalks are really common. So these are fully walkable systems. They are ADA compliant once they've been filled in, either with stone or with topsoil. So you can definitely use them for trails, for sidewalks and parking lots, that sort of thing. You don't have to worry about creating additional accessible areas. These all will meet those accessible requirements. And there are a number of extensive benefits to using a porous pavement system in your GI or LID land planning. So let's go over some of those. So I've said it a couple times, but the cell walls of the geopave aggregate unit are intended to be visible. You can see them in the right-hand photo here. So they were designed with a herringbone pattern, similar to a paver stone aesthetic. Additionally, the infill can be varied to create a sense of separation, useful for walkways, parking lots, road shoulders, that sort of thing. The geoblock vegetated units allow for that full grass growth with a natural look. So you just get that nice green lawn that you see in the left-hand photo. And the cell walls are not visible. You're not seeing any plastic there. So whatever look you're going for on your site, you can achieve with one of these products. So without that unfinished look that tends to be really common with porous concrete or porous asphalt. A wellness retreat in Door County in northern Wisconsin used the geopaved stone system to help achieve lead silver on their site, due in part to the stormwater storage utilized within this system. And an office building in Florida used the geoblock grass system as a fire access lane while still looking like a normal lawn area. So two different applications, standard parking lot versus fire access lane, but both great applications for our porous pavement systems. And both of our products offer significant storage of stormwater in the cross section as it moves into the groundwater system. Because the water infiltrates through the system, there's going to be minimal sheet runoff at the surface. So you're reducing your flooding potential on and around your pavement. The aggregate surface pavements, such as GeoPave, have a high percentage of open area and utilize a highly permeable open graded aggregate infill. So the stormwater infiltrates exceptionally fast. And vegetated surface pavements, like the GeoBlock system, help keep the topsoil loose and protected against compaction. So you still have that good grass growth and allow water to infiltrate faster than a typical vegetated area on site. There are some other porous pavements that claim to be out there on the market that are made with geotextiles only, so like a fabric-based system, rather than, you know, the rigid plastic that we've been offering in our two systems. And this really requires slow percolation of the water, so you tend to have a lot of ponding at the surface, which sort of defeats the purpose of a porous pavement, and it just doesn't provide the same amount of strength. So keep in mind that there are some competitors out there, but they just don't offer the same full service solution that our products do. So the rigid paver units align well with your existing asphalt or other traditional pavements. You can sort of see that here. In a car dealership parking lot, it was an addition that they wanted to add on. This was done up in Brooklyn, New York. So the paver units do come in rectangles, but they can easily be field cut to handle curves, existing structures such as manholes, and any other obstacles that may be on site. So the aggregate GeoPave and the vegetated GeoBlock units, when they work in concert with a hard surface pavement, are actually so porous that they can handle the sheet runoff from your impervious parking areas without the need for additional stormwater infrastructure. So you don't need things such as drainage swales, retention ponds, or water conveyance pipes to collect that water. You can let it percolate through the GeoPave or the GeoBlock system into your groundwater system. So it really helps if you are limited on space. So this is going to be a typical cross section for the GeoPave system. So the GeoPave unit itself is 2 inches deep. So the depth of the overall system is going to depend on the amount of open graded base course that may be required underneath the unit. So there's going to be a variety of factors that decide that depth of the base course. And one of those factors is going to be how well the native soil allows infiltration. Clay does not infiltrate water as quickly as sand does. So if you know that you have something that really impedes that infiltration, if you have a really clayey soil, you might want to have additional base underneath the unit just to help collect that stormwater and avoid potential runoff. I do want to note that there is no need for a choker or a bedding course underneath the GeoPave unit. So there's not going to be a layer that limits the amount of stormwater infiltration. You go straight into an open graded stone, so really allowing that water to flow through as quickly as possible. You may or may not place a geotextile underneath the system if you want. This could be really helpful if you're looking for some filtration capabilities, if you need to know that you're having some filtration, either of particulates or anything like that. I won't try and pretend like I have full knowledge of that sort of thing, but it is something really common we see often enough that people are looking for that extra filtration. Feel free to throw a geotextile filtration fabric underneath the system. Provide that requirement if necessary, and it's not going to be detrimental to the strength of the GeoPave system. So going back to that base layer, may or may not be necessary, but that biggest factor in determining that depth is going to be the strength of the native soil on your site. And this is expressed as the California bearing ratio, the CBR of the soil. So the higher the ratio, the stronger the soil. And the strength of the GeoPave aggregate system is enough that even for the highest load ratings from AASHTO, which is H HS25 loadings. This is going to be fully loaded emergency vehicles, things like concrete trucks, dump trucks, anything like that. There's actually a pretty low base depth requirement, only 6 inches total, compared to up to 14 inches or even more underneath traditional concrete or porous asphalt, things like that. So pretty big difference. And it is important to note that this table is showing minimum depth requirements. You can always add more depth to the base if you want to store more stormwater during a storm event. So definitely possible. And if you are interested in that sort of thing, feel free to reach out. We're happy to talk about the implications of that or how much stormwater you could actually hold in the system. Always happy to discuss that sort of thing on a project by project basis. So this is just something that we offer. It's a design assistant tool. It's for free on our website. It's just a quick little calculator that provides a really basic cross section, but it can be really helpful during the beginning of a design process. And if needed, we have some additional calculations and can provide things like CAD details and other resources such as that through our engineering team, myself and the rest of the engineering team here. But this can be a really good first step when you first start talking to your regulators to show that there is stormwater storage with this type of system. So it works with all of our different porous pavement products, and it's a pretty easy tool to help determine what may be most appropriate for your site. So like I said, it's just a free calculator. It's on our website, available for download. And if you do have any questions about how it works, definitely feel free to reach out. And now we're going to do a quick case study on the GeoPave aggregate system. Everybody likes to know that this stuff actually does work in the real world. So this was a project at the Citadel in South Carolina, and close proximity to a saltwater marsh and strict stormwater regulations limiting runoff and pollutants into the critical tidal area were some major concerns when they were doing renovations of an alumni parking lot. So the client wanted a really low maintenance, low environmental impact solution to replace the failing asphalt pavement that had become overcompacted and had developed things like alligator cracking and potholes. We've all seen that. It's pretty awful to drive over. And basically they were saying there wasn't space on their site to have things such as conventional stormwater detention ponds or that bioswale, anything to collect the stormwater. So they needed to switch to a porous pavement. So rigid gravel pavers, the GeoPave units, were utilized as this low impact solution. Installation is actually really quite straightforward, even if you've never used it before. The paver units are installed over a non-woven geotextile. That was their choice for a filtration fabric. And then they're connected to form a contiguous interconnected area across the entire parking lot. In this case, they decided not to have any additional base. So the overall cross section for this project was really quite thin, which meant reduced excavating costs, reduced material costs, all those good things that everybody wants to see. So an open graded aggregate was next installed, and it's just raked straight into the GeoPave cells. So standard lightweight construction equipment can be used. There's no need for specialty equipment or any specialty training. And this crew, which had no prior experience installing the GeoPave units, was able to achieve an installation rate of around 1,200 square feet a day, including excavation and infilling of stone. So got up there pretty quickly for having never even seen this product before. So the open graded aggregate is highly permeable. I know I've been saying that a lot. So open graded aggregate really just in this context means that you limit the fines content. So anything passing that number 200 sieve, you really want to limit those fines because that actually has the potential to limit the amount of infiltration capacity. By having it be open graded, having a lot of space between each one of the stones allows for maximum water flow through the system. So that's what I mean when I say open graded aggregate, and that's how that sort of works with this type of system. And it really allows the water to collect within the void spaces within the aggregate and drain naturally without getting clogged or running off at the surface. This client could have installed additional base if it had been desired, if they needed extra storage, but their hydrologist had decided that wasn't strictly necessary, so they were going for that nice thin cross section. So the porous parking stalls were also designed to collect runoff from the adjacent hard pavement drive lanes. Like I said, it was able to collect the sheet runoff without needing to have that extra infrastructure, such as a retention bond. And then here's the sort of update photo. This is about a decade after installation. So the product is still in use, still looks as pretty much as good as the day it was installed. There's very little need for maintenance with the aggregate because the stone is actually confined within the paver unit. So it's not getting pushed around. It's not rutting or getting lost where it has to constantly be replaced. All that stone is staying in place. We do have a couple recommended tips for keeping the geopave pavement in good shape. That includes things like keeping the lot clear of organics. So if you have a lot of falling leaves that sort of could collect in this area, you do want to either rake or leaf blow those out of the way so that they don't collect on top of the pavement. And then if you are in a cold weather environment where there's potentially snow and you want to use a snow plow, you want to just keep that snow plow blade half an inch to an inch above the top of the unit so that you don't have accidental contact between the two. So I know placing porous pavements in cold weather and snowy conditions is a concern for a lot of regulators, engineers, contractors. It's definitely a concern. So we actually have quite a bit of information available on our website answering a lot of the common questions that we see, or you can feel free to contact us directly and we are more than happy to help alleviate concerns. But know that we've installed this in a lot of different very cold weather locations, you know, northern Canada, that type of thing, where there's a lot of snow, a lot of ice. And we've seen it be very successful without a lot of concern. So it's definitely possible. And if you do have any questions about that, we're happy to talk about it. Okay, we also have another case study. This time we're sort of switching gears and we're going to talk about the geoblock vegetated system. And so this was actually used for a parking lot and a pedestrian walkway area. So this was for the Nattapawassee Huron Band of the Potawatomi tribe. So this was done in southern Michigan, Battle Creek, Michigan. They were looking to create a parking area for their trailers and then a walkway down to their powwow grounds. The ground was actually a really soft clay that would cause the heavy trailers to get caught and bogged down. So because this was a wilderness area, the NHBP was looking for a more natural look than having to install an asphalt parking lot. So the vegetated geoblock product was a great choice for this area because it's used pretty infrequently, so that grass is going to grow nicely, but it would also support the heavy vehicle loads as necessary. So the system was installed in October of 2019, so everything was done before the snows came in. The ground was stripped of any vegetation and leveled off, and then the geoblock panels were placed. They were placed in a herringbone pattern, which is recommended when there's going to be bi-directional traffic or that lots of turning and movement, anything you might see really common in a trailer parking area. They chose to put a base layer underneath it, about 2 inches, and so that satisfied the requirements based on the expected vehicle loading. So this gave a total of a 4-inch cross section. So again, pretty thin cross section requiring minimal excavation. And the cells were then filled in with a local topsoil reclaimed from the excavation process. So this is how the system looks immediately after that topsoil installation. So the panels can be driven on like this. So the soil fills in. You do still see the plastic right now because there isn't any grass growth. But the system is now usable. You can drive on it, you can use it, all that good stuff while you wait for the grass to grow. So there's not going to be that lag time between being able to use the system after you've installed it. And then here we are in the summer of 2021, so about 2 years after installation. The geo-block panels are no longer visible, so you might never guess that this area was actually reinforced. So it's now a parking lot for cars and trailers, and it's safe for walking and playing on. With full grass growth there, the lawn can be maintained with a standard lawnmower or landscaping equipment. You know, simple, no fuss, no muss, no special equipment necessary. And in the winter, when the snows come, you can either scrape the snow off, like I described before, or just let it build up and melt off over time like a normal lawn. Depends on what you need it for. Okay, so that was all porous pavements. So now we're going to sort of switch gears and talk about another way to reduce runoff and integrate green infrastructure into your designs. And that's going to be with bioswales and vegetated stormwater channels. So grassed swales help collect parking lot overflow, so that sheet runoff that's coming from your impervious parking lot areas, slowing and infiltrating the water, and then also directing it into storm drains. So swales and drainage ditches are typically intended for low to moderate and intermediate flows. So nothing really high, fast, high velocity, and it's not intended to have water in it constantly. So we use the GeoWeb GeoCell system to help confine the topsoil and vegetation in place so that it doesn't have any failure through erosion. And so we don't have time today to go into much detail about GeoCells, but I'll talk about it a little bit, but we have tons of information on our website. And just know that the GeoWeb system is the leading GeoCell product on the market today. So if there are any questions about the technical aspects of the GeoWeb system, like I said, we have that extensive information on our website. We have lots of other webinars where I've talked about this in great detail. So you can look at those or feel free to contact us, and we are more than happy to discuss specifics one-on-one. So we did do testing with the GeoWeb system, and you can see that in the lower right-hand photo, what the GeoWeb panel would look like. We did this at Colorado State University with Dr. Chris Thornton. This was to show how GeoCells, how the GeoWeb system functions in channel and embankment applications. So vegetated channels can be designed for higher flows when they are stabilized with the GeoWeb system and when they have some sort of overlayment, usually either an erosion control blanket or a turf reinforcement mat. So the improvement when stabilized with the GeoWeb system is incredibly high. It can handle up to 30 feet per second compared to 5 to 6 feet per second if you use an erosion control blanket alone. So massive difference. And this allows for lower impact vegetated channels to be used instead of expensive high maintenance riprap, concrete, or articulated concrete blocks. So if you are interested in any sort of additional information about that GeoWeb testing that we did, we have our independent research summaries. And these were done for topsoil, crushed aggregate, and concrete infill. So just let us know if you need a copy of this for your project or just for your own information. Always happy to discuss how well these systems worked, because they actually really did. They were a great option. And we really think that this is something that a lot of people should use. So here's an example of erosion on an unprotected roadside ditch, and then how it's repaired with the GeoWeb and a TRM solution. So notice that there's pretty significant erosion from the sheet flow runoff on the left-hand side. The grass isn't growing. You're getting some pretty deep rills and gullies forming. It has the potential to undermine the road if it keeps up over time. With the GeoWeb system, the water flows over top of the system without eroding, without removing the soil, without allowing for any undermining of that road. So you're not going to have damage to that road over time. So it's good for both the roadside ditch and it's good for the road. GeoWeb vegetated channels can be designed either as sort of a single layer, like we just saw in the last photo, or it could be designed as a tiered retaining wall structure. And that's sort of what we're seeing here. So these are, again, intended for sort of moderate flows and then intermittent water. So again, you don't want standing water. You really don't want that standing water because to allow for vegetation growth. if you know you have a channel that's always going to have water in it, you would want to have something like a stone or a concrete as your facing of the channel. And that's definitely possible with the GWEB system, not specifically what we're talking about today. But if you have a project where that might be a thing, feel free to reach out. Happy to discuss, just not what we're talking about today. So these channels, when they're designed as these sort of tiered systems, can be designed to have a really narrow horizontal footprint. So it can accommodate more volume in a smaller space to help mitigate that flooding. And this can be really good when you're either doing new construction or renovation, but you already have existing infrastructure. You have a roadway, you have buildings, you have things that just can't be removed. So you have a really narrow footprint. This can be a great way to be able to support all of the anticipated water flow you might have without having to look for additional space. So another case study, always like looking at those for a vegetated channel project. So the GeoWeb system works great along the shorelines of stormwater channels. By placing the panels along a shoreline, you can help protect against erosion, be that water movement or wave action. So this channel was along a stormwater diversion channel in southern Florida that actually helps move hurricane waters. So during the hopefully infrequent hurricane season, the channel would flood, and before the GeoWeb system had severe erosion on these side slopes every time that would happen. So there's obviously infrastructure on either side of the road, so it was really important to help keep the channel within its banks. So the GeoWeb panels are placed both above and below the average water line for this type of project. The panels need to go below that water line to ensure that they don't get lifted up during wave action and help protect the entire shoreline, all the way from the crest down to a stabilized channel bed. The area does not have to be dewatered for this type of system. You can install with full water in the channels you see here. The GeoWeb panels have the potential to float initially, but eventually they would be staked down to help hold them in place. And then once you place that infill material, system's not going anywhere. And here you can see the final surface after vegetation has been established. So the performance of the GeoWeb system allows it to handle fluctuations in the water depth and the associated velocities or shear stresses that would come with that, while preventing erosion on the side slopes. And so using a soil or a grass type that's local to your area, maybe even using that salvaged material if you have some excavation that's done, will help with blending in the system so that the GeoWeb panels aren't noticeable. But now you can walk along this shoreline without fear of sinking in, and the shoreline is going to be protected against erosion for years to come. And one last thing about vegetated infill, I just want to highlight using the GeoWeb system along channel side slopes. And so notice how the panels just cover the sides, not the bottom of the channel. So this is absolutely doable, and it's actually pretty common just to need to protect the side slopes. If you do need to protect the channel bottom, the GeoWeb panels can absolutely cover the whole area. But typically, it's really only the side slopes that are seeing those significant erosion issues because of that fluctuation in water level. So the GeoWeb panels will allow for that vegetation growth up both embankments, which would normally be underwater. And in this case, you can see a bright yellow geomembrane liner underneath the panel. So in this case, you don't want to necessarily punch stakes through. You might need to use a tendon system. What type of anchorage you need is going to be dependent on your project-specific details. That's something we can help you determine. But it is definitely an option to have these sort of impenetrable liners underneath the system and then still allow them to be filled in with vegetation so that they can have that grass growth because the soil is held within the GeoWeb panels. So now when the stormwater channel does become flooded because of a storm event, the side slopes are protected and the channel can do its job. And again, maintenance is really easy on these type of systems. Lawn mowing can happen with your, if you have that regular grass with your standard lawnmower. Both a walk behind and a riding mower are totally fine and they're not going to damage the system at all. Or if you pick flowering vegetation or those sort of tall grasses that you see, then you don't need to have any maintenance to begin with. So it really is a nice sort of place it and forget it type of system. And now, our very last section of the day, because we are getting a little close to the end of our time. So we're going to focus on green retaining walls and how they can contribute to your low environmental impact goals. So the GeoWeb system can actually be adapted to create these retaining walls, such as that vegetated levee, that tiered structure that we saw a couple slides back. So the GeoWeb walls are created by stacking multiple panels of the GeoWeb system on top of one another to achieve your required height, and then allowing vegetation to grow over the front face of the wall to create a living green wall rather than showing concrete or gabion baskets or masonry walls. So the primary benefit of using a GeoWeb wall is to create a stable, natural living structure with vegetation for that good aesthetic appeal. The open front fascia allows that rainwater to infiltrate, and so the structure can actually absorb runoff from the top of the wall. So if you place it underneath a parking lot, it can absorb sheet flow runoff from parking lot or roadway, that sort of thing, into the GeoWeb wall without erosion damage or, you know, overflow concerns. So GeoWeb walls are generally vegetated. It's kind of what we're talking about today, that living green wall. But they can also be designed with an aggregate or a stone infill and still be considered permeable. The water can still flow through that open graded stone. And so they're designed either as gravity or reinforced walls in the same way that other mechanically stabilized earth or MSE walls would be installed. Again, not getting into wall design details today, but if you do have questions, we have lots of information. So an advantage that the GeoWeb walls have over things like MSE block walls is their flexibility in poor soil conditions. The relative light weight of the GeoWeb system allows them to tolerate reasonable differential settlement quite well in a way that concrete walls just couldn't. And another advantage over traditional walls, such as gabion basket walls, is the relatively shallow depth of the wall into your wall face. So its ability to have a really steep wall face, steep as 80 degrees, without needing a lot of internal excavation. Okay, one last case study, make sure we all know how this works in the real world. So this was a vegetated retaining wall below a gravel road next to a small intermittent stream. So you can see that the GeoWeb wall was built up in the overflow area of the stream amid riprap that's intended to help prevent erosion. The GeoWeb wall was placed to provide support for the road that's on the right-hand side of this photo. So we're not going to talk about the construction of the wall today. Again, we have those resources. We have a webinar dedicated to this topic. So we're just looking at the wall as it's already been built. So like I said, the GeoWeb panels are sort of stacked vertically on top of one another. They're filled in with soil. And then for this particular case, they chose to coat the entire wall face in hydro seed to help promote vegetation growth. So there's a lot of flexibility with GeoWeb walls. So you can see them placed around curves, they can adapt to different heights or ground elevations, and they can support some pretty heavy loads when properly designed. So this wall is 100% functional as it is right now. We're just sort of waiting for the vegetation to make it look a little more filled in. If you choose to use an aggregate infill rather than vegetation, this would be the final look of the wall, just for reference. But you can start using that road behind the wall immediately, and it will help protect against erosion from the stream if overflowing were necessary. So here you can see the grass is starting to come in nicely just a couple months after installation. You can also see that a fence was installed at the top of the wall. So this is a pretty easy thing to incorporate into a GeoWeb wall. So don't let the need for other infrastructure dissuade you from using the GeoWeb system. This was a photo about a year after installation, so vegetation has now been fully established, and the GeoWeb panels are no longer obviously visible. There's no real maintenance required for GeoWeb walls like this, so just the visual inspection is all that's really required. You don't have to cut or maintain the vegetation unless you want to, but this just sort of leads into choosing a vegetation that you don't have to. Make it easy for yourself. Choose something that doesn't require constant maintenance, and then you can just place it and forget it. And then this was a photo about 5 years after installation. Looks pretty picturesque, don't you think? So the wall will help protect this area if the stream does flood, and the fence and the road above the wall aren't going anywhere due to the strength of the wall. This is probably the most common outcome for a GWAB wall, is that they just sort of disappear into the landscape. You forget that it's even there, but it's doing its job. It's supporting all of the other infrastructure around it, and you don't have to worry about erosion concerns anymore. Okay, so reached the end. So in summary, you can see that there are a lot of ways to reduce stormwater runoff and minimize the environmental impact of your built environment. Using rigid porous paver technology for water management is a great alternative to stormwater collection off roadways and parking lots. Then creating green infrastructure with drainage swales or living walls will help you achieve your green infrastructure and low impact development goals. We offer a complete system solution for a wide variety of applications based on project specific details and conditions. And part of our complete solution is going to be our technical assistance. That's myself and the rest of the engineering team here. So we provide free project evaluations. So this is something that we can help you determine which product is going to be the most appropriate for your needs, whether there's any sort of anchorage requirements if you're on a slope, whether a geotextile or a filter fabric may be helpful, that sort of thing. So you can either fill out a form that's on our website, or you can email us directly. You can just sort of give us as much information as you have. You can include things such as geotechnical reports, site documents, that sort of thing. Comes to myself and the rest of the engineering team. And usually within about 3 business days, but also a lot faster, we can provide this complete system evaluation with everything that you're going to need to successfully integrate one of these systems at your project site. And we're going to work with you to get the best design for your project. We're not just trying to, you know, sort of sell you, here's a product, good luck, have fun, disappear on you. We really want to help you make sure that this is going to be the most appropriate thing for you. And this is now going to be a little bit of housekeeping. So we've made it faster and easier for you to obtain your PDH certificates. So you have earned one full credit of PDH for listening to me talk today. And so with our webinar dashboard, you can easily view our library of webinars. I've talked about how we have a couple other ones out there with lots of really good information. And then you can also download your PDH certificates for any of the on-demand webinars that you've completed. So your webinar dashboard will keep a record of all the on-demand webinars that you've completed, along with your PDH credits earned. And so please note that certificates from the live webinar, which if you're listening to me talk on Tuesday, this is live, they're going to be managed separately. So you're actually going to receive an email from GoToWebinar within about 24 hours with your certificate. So check your spam folder if you haven't seen that in about 24 hours from now. It's coming from GoToWebinar, not Presto Geosystems. But in 2 to 3 days, so by the end of the week, you will receive a separate email from Presto Geosystems with more information about accessing the on-demand webinar dashboard and some other helpful resources about what we talked about today. So if you don't receive either of these emails, again, check your spam folder, look for both GoToWebinar and Presto Geosystems for those emails. Okay, so here's my contact info, both my phone and my email. Feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions about what we talked about today or what we didn't talk about today, or if you have any projects that you think one of our products might be useful for. Always happy to help, even in really preliminary stages, even if it's, you know, hey, I vaguely have a project in mind, always happy to help talk about it. So if you have to go, I fully understand that. We've been here for about an hour. I really appreciate your time. If not, I am going to go through a couple questions that have come through the questions tab. So today's webinar has been recorded, and the Q&A session here will also be recorded. So if you do have to go, feel free to check the webinar dashboard in a couple days when you receive that email. Skip to the end of this webinar and the Q&A session will be there. So with that, let's see what some questions people might have. So some of them are, how effective is cleaning the porous pavements to remove the fine materials? So this is something that we talked about way back in the beginning. And that's sort of one of the big issues with sort of the traditional porous pavement. So your porous concrete, your porous asphalt, is they get clogged over time and you need to sort of vacuum out those clogs. And it's one of the things that our products, the GeoPave aggregate system and the GeoBlock vegetated system, were built to try and eliminate the need to have to remove clogs or to get clogs in the first place. And so it's, how do you remove those fines, those fine materials that could create clogs, so that you still have that good water infiltration. So with the GeoBlock system, which is vegetated, it's not really an issue. It's topsoil, you're not really collecting fines, clogs aren't really happening. So we're not going to talk about that much. But with GeoPave, so with the aggregate system, what would you do if you were to get clogs, if there were fines, that sort of thing? So the first thing I would say is, it's really not going to be a huge concern. This isn't something that you need to think about saying, man, every other month I've got to go out and vacuum the system, something like that. It's really not going to be something that you have to do very often. But if you are noticing that there's ponding at the surface for some reason, or you think that there's been a lot of fines material added to the system that could be creating clogs, one of the best things you could do is just a little bit of power washing. So just spray down, try and get those fines materials to actually flow through the system and out without needing to sort of collect them at the surface, get them to just flow down through the base material and out the sides. So power washing is probably the easiest way to do that. If you think that that's not solving the issue, you could do a little bit of light vacuuming. So there are some vacuum trucks that you can sort of run over the top of gravel surfaces that have a grate on them so that they don't pick up the stone, but they do pick up the sands or the fines material. Like I said, really don't think you're going to need to do that. It's really not something that we've seen a lot of with our long-term projects. We don't hear about people saying they need to do that very often, but there are options if it does need to happen, and we're happy to discuss those if it's something that you think you need on one of your projects. So another question, what are some load limits on the pavers? This is something that we talked about really briefly, but basically load limits are anything that's going to be applicable on a roadway surface is going to be able to be used on the paver units. So we're talking ASHTO load ratings is probably one of the more common ways of thinking about it. Like I said, at one point, ASHTO HS25 loadings. This is basically the heaviest vehicles that are allowed on a standard roadway. So emergency vehicles, dump trucks, fully loaded concrete trucks, that sort of thing. You can use all of that all the way up to those emergency vehicles on both types of paver units. You may need to have additional base underneath the paver unit to help support that load if you have very soft soils. That's something that our project evaluations can help you determine. But really, you shouldn't be thinking that there's a restriction due to heavy vehicle loads, because there's really not. We can and have fully supported the heaviest vehicles that are allowed on roadways on our paver units. So it might result in a deeper cross section, but there's no real load restrictions. Lots of questions about, using these types of systems in cold weather environments, especially where you have the potential to see freeze-thaw cycles. And yes, this is definitely, everyone is pretty concerned about this, unless you're somewhere near the equator in some sunny locale where you don't have to worry about snow, in which case I'm a little jealous of you. But for the rest of us who are stuck with winter months, what do you do with porous pavements? And so the answer is, the way the GeoBlock and GeoPave units have been designed is to allow some expansion and contraction of the panels themselves due to the thermal environment. So as it gets cold and hot and you have the that freeze-thaw cycle, the panels themselves actually have a little bit of breathing room, basically, so that you don't see buckling and you don't see failure of the system due to that freeze-thaw cycle. Another benefit to it is the open graded aggregate, that aggregate with lots of void space between the stones where you have that minimal fines content, actually helps with the freeze-thaw cycle as well. By having those void spaces, you're actually having some air entrapment. So you're sort of keeping air in there when there's not water, but you have air in there that actually helps allow for, again, that expansion and contraction during the freeze-thaw cycle. So you have a little bit of movement allowed sort of horizontally, where you then aren't seeing vertical movement where you would see buckling or you would see damage to the surface. And so sort of how the whole thing works together, the way the panels are designed and the stone that you use, all of those things help maintain a stable system, even in cold weather environments. And then when you do have snow or you do have ice that falls and accumulates on top of the system, you can either let the snow melt, just let it melt into the groundwater system. You can put things like salts or de-icers on there. It would help the snow melt faster, but just sort of keep in mind that that would allow the salt or the chemicals to sort of percolate into your groundwater system. They're not getting washed away. So something to keep in mind, especially if you are in sort of a protected area, if you're in a wetland, you might not want to have salts, that sort of thing. So that's maybe a little project dependent, but it is possible to just let that snow melt. Or you can use snow plows, either the walk behind or, the car or truck snow plows. And really, you just want to make sure that there's not direct contact between that plow blade and the panel material. If you run a plow blade with the power of a truck behind it, yeah, you're going to cause some damage to the system. Can't deny that. But if you just keep it a little bit above, so just leave a little bit of a gap between the top of the panels and where your plow blade is, you can scrape all that snow off and you'll be good to go. So we have lots of information about this on our website. We have an FAQ where we get a lot of these questions, or feel free to reach out to us directly. We're happy to talk to you. We've also connected with local regulators in your area where you might need, manufacturers sort of approval saying, yes, we've seen this done successfully. We're here to help alleviate your concerns. That's also possible. Let's see some other questions here. Are there any type of parking delineators available? So what you can do is we actually have them. I'm sorry, I didn't have them included in my webinar today. We actually have little plastic units that can clip directly into the paver units that are either bright yellow or bright blue. And those sort of help you delineate. You can make parking lines, you can indicate accessible areas versus not, all that sort of things to help sort of customize your parking lot or your porous pavement area. Yes, we have those little delineators, or you can include sort of non-traditional or traditional. You could go with wheel stops, you can put in bollards, you can put heavy boulders along the edge saying, don't drive past here, don't drive over the rocks sort of thing. So there's a lot of different ways that you can include delineators or other sort of markers or anything you want to do to sort of customize the system that can be included with both the GeoBlock and GeoPave systems to help make sure that it's going to work really well for you. But yes, we do have specific delineators available for our products if that's what you're looking for. Let's see, last question, because I've gone over time. Is the base layer of the GeoBlock also native soil? So the GeoBlock is the vegetated system. This is a really great question. So we typically actually recommend that the base layer underneath the GeoBlock panels be a mixture of soil and stone. So we tend to call this engineered base. And so it's a mixture of that soil and stone to help support vehicle loads while still allowing for full grass growth. And then you just put pure topsoil or sod in the actual geoblock panels themselves. So you have that good growing medium. And so by having the mixture of stone and soil underneath the geoblock panels gives you that little bit of extra support, helps maintain the strength and the structure of the overall system, but it's not impeding your water flow and it's not impeding your grass growth. So that's a great question. And it's definitely, we have lots of resources about that. We have directions on how to make that engineered base for your site or how to get it to you, that sort of thing. So I've gone over my time. I thank you, anybody that is still listening. Like I said, look out for those emails, either from GoToWebinar or Presto Geosystems in the next couple of days. And if you do have any questions or if I didn't get to your question today, please feel free to reach out either to myself directly or through our website at prestogeo.com. We would be more than happy to talk about any questions that you may have. So I hope you all have a wonderful rest of your day and that we hear from you soon. Bye.